You've found a portal for a firmware upgrade service responsible for the deployment and maintenance of rogue androids hunting humans outside of Tractor City. The question is, what are you going to do about it? This is the description of Slippy, an easy difficulty web challenge from the HackTheBox University's CTF 2021 that was also reposted on HackTheBox after the end of the event. The challenge focuses on exploiting an old known zip issue, currently known as zip slip, to leverage a path traversal vulnerability in the application and obtain remote code execution. Before starting, if you enjoyed the video at any point or you find it interesting, please let me know it with a comment and dropping a like. And if you're new here and you're interested in other content like this, I invite you to subscribe to the channel and turn on notifications so you don't miss any new content. Okay, without spending any more time, let's get started. As with most web challenges, we are given the option to start the remote server instance, but also the option to recreate the same environment locally. Downloading and unzipping the archive, we can clearly see that it provides a ready-to-go Docker environment as well as the application source code. Having the source code of an application is very useful. It allows you to understand the logic and the main features behind a program, but most importantly, it allows you to identify any specific shortcomings forgot by developers. We can start the Docker container by simply running the build docker sh script that builds the environment starting from the Docker file contained within the same folder and then runs it, binding the local port 1337 to the Docker's corresponding one. At this point, we are able to interact with the challenge website by simply browsing localhost on port 1337. Slippy firmware upgrader. Please select a newer version of firmware tar.gz file to upload. This site is basically a control panel from which you can upload tar.gz files that will then be processed in some way by the server. Application accepts only tar.gz files. Trying to load other file formats, it displays an error message. Okay, so let's create a valid archive containing just a simple plain text file and let's see what happens. The application extracts all the files contained in the archive and provides us with a sort of directory list from which we can access them. Looking at the path where the files are placed, it seems that the server creates specific random unpredictable folders contained within the archives directory. However, only by looking at the code we can be sure of that. We can also try to upload malicious files in order to obtain some sort of server-side template injection or XSS through their contents or their name. In this case, we found an XSS, but there is no way to get the flag via this vulnerability. If this was a pen test for a client, we would have to report this issue, but since our goal is to get the flag, we can move on. Alright, I think it's time to take a look at the provided source code and try to understand how this application works. Every time a Docker file is provided, I always start by looking at it first. Here we can see that the application is using Flask, so we are dealing with a Python backend, and its base path on the server is /app. Looking at the files inside the challenge folder, we can find a test flag and run.py, basically the launcher for the web server. An interesting information contained within this file is that the server is executed with the debug flag enabled, allowing to reload application code when it changes without the need to restart the server. Looking at the application, we can see other interesting stuff. Main.py imports two routes from blueprints routes.py. Web, which renders and returns the index.html page, and API, which is routed to /unslippy, and which perform all the various operations on the uploaded archive file. This API implements from util.py the function named extract from archive, the core functionality of the application. Let's investigate better what this function does. It first stores the provided archive within a temp directory. Then it checks if the file is a tar file, and if it's true, it extracts all the contained files within the temp folder. It creates a custom random folder within app application static archives. Then for every file contained within the uploaded archive, it extracts the name, checks that it is a regular file in order to not include links, and finally move the file from the temp folder to the currently randomly generated one. Once the entire process is finished, it returns the list of all files that have been extracted. At this point, the most experienced viewer has already understood where the vulnerability is, but let's rebuild the Docker image, introducing some debugging information to help beginners. From the source code, we noticed that developers didn't perform any kind of control on file names. They just checked for regular file, denying the possibility to upload links. Files, however, can contain special character, as we already saw with the image one. Back in the days, in 2018, a particular type of vulnerability named ZipSlip was discovered and disclosed by Snyk Security. Yes, I say discovered, quotes included, because the same vulnerability had already been discussed and exploited back in the years, as shown by Live Overflow on its own dedicated video. So they didn't technically discover it. Anyway, the vulnerability exploits the possibility to include within different archives files having directory traversal names associated. If applications implementing those features do not properly validate file names, this behavior can lead to the overwriting of arbitrary files and in some cases also to code execution. Our target has exactly this kind of problem. It takes for granted that the files don't contain special characters, extracting them using the extractall module, even if in the official documentation it is written. Warning: never extract archives from untrusted sources without prior inspection. It is possible that files are created outside of the path. For example, members that have absolute file names starting with slash or file names with two dots. To be safe, the application should have implemented a custom control logic filtering those specific use cases. However, it is not the case, and so let's see what happens when we provide to the application an archive containing a relative path. Boom! As expected, the application doesn't check for path traversal reference in files names and allows to write outside of the intended path. At this point, we can exploit the vulnerability in two different ways. The first technique, which is the most disruptive and risky, consists of overwriting the application backend by altering the program logic. You can introduce a new route inside routes.py that points to the flag, as shown in the following video by John Hammond, or you can poison the extract from archive function to execute arbitrary Python code, as shown in the following video by CryptoCat. The second technique, a bit more secure, consists of injecting an init.py file within the application folder. The init.py files are required to make Python treat the directories as containing packages. This is done to prevent directories with a common name, such as string, from unintentionally hiding valid modules that occur later on the module search path. Init.py can just be an empty file, but it can also execute initialization code for the package. If we can inject the init.py file with arbitrary Python code inside the directory of the web application that acts as a package, then we can achieve code execution if that package is imported by the application. Luckily, util.py uses application as a package directory to import main. We can craft a malicious archive that exploited the ZipSlip vulnerability to write the init.py file inside app application. Then we can craft another archive, this time containing the desired malicious code, to overwrite it, forcing the server to dynamically update the application source code. Finally, we can import a third random file in order to force the server to import main and thus execute our code contained within the injected init file. Here we go. As we can see from the hacked file generated inside the Docker image, we can execute arbitrary Python code. Now, let's update the payload to save the flag inside a known directory, and then let's start the challenge on HTTP. First, let's upload our init archive in order to store the init file within the right folder. Now, let's upload the archive containing the real payload in order to force the update of the backend's code, and finally, let's upload a random file to force the server importing main.py and thus execute the init code. We got it! HDB, I slipped my way to RCE. This was my solution for Slippy. Have you ever heard about this vulnerability back in the days, or did you ever face it during other CTFs or pentests? Let me know it in the comment section below. Thanks to everyone who stayed with me up to here. I hope you enjoyed the video and that you found it useful. If so, please consider leaving me a like and subscribe to the channel so we can meet again in the next video. Having said that, see you next time. Ciao!